Headline Review. An imprint of Headline Publishing Group Limited presents The Woman on the Bridge by Sheila O'Flanagan. Read by Grainne Gillis. Chapter 1. Dublin, Summer 1920. Winifred was measuring out a length of fabric, pushing the sky blue silk along the brass ruler at the edge of the wooden countertop with the tips of her fingers, and enjoying the feel of the delicate material as it brushed her skin. She didn't need to use the ruler. She instinctively knew exactly how much she was measuring out. But Mrs. Kelly, the owner of the city centre drapery shop where she'd worked for the past 5 years, insisted on fabrics being measured exactly, no matter that Winifred's estimate was as precise as any ruler. And so Winifred did as she was told, even when, like today, Mrs. Kelly wasn't in the shop and there was nobody to check if she followed the rules or not. Her fingertips moved to the rhythm of the large white enamel clock on the wall behind her, its slender second-hand ticking by the black Roman numerals, while she lost herself in visions of how the blue silk dresses would look when they were finally made. She wished she could afford to have a silk dress of her own, but Winifred's clothes were hard-wearing and practical, for a life that was hard-working and practical too. Nevertheless, she was imagining walking down a long staircase in a blue evening gown, picturing herself smiling graciously at the people around her when the enormous stone came crashing through the shop window. She shrieked as it rolled along the narrow display area before thudding onto the wooden floor like a miniature cannonball. She abandoned the billowing waves of silk to duck beneath the counter, while razor-sharp shards of glass cascaded around her. The shouts and yells of the people running along the narrow street outside grew louder and angrier. Then she thought she heard a shot being fired. "No, no, no," she gasped as she tried to slow the frantic beating of her heart. "Please let it not be anything to do with Mrs. Kelly. Please let them keep running. Please don't come in here. Please." Although the reasons to target Kelly's fine fabrics were slim, Alice Kelly wasn't blatantly taking one side or the other in the War of Independence that was raging across Ireland. It didn't mean that someone, somewhere, mightn't have regarded the shop as fair game. The atmosphere in the city was becoming more tense with every passing day, and the least thing could lead to unexpected violence. Last month, there'd been a skirmish between Republicans and the Royal Irish Constabulary right outside the door, which had led to it bursting open and two men rolling across the floor before the Republican was arrested and marched outside again. Winifred was beginning to think that working in a drapery shop was almost as dangerous as being a volunteer. The shouting grew louder, and beneath the counter, Winifred tried to make herself smaller. "All she wanted was a quiet life," she muttered to herself. But how was anyone supposed to have a quiet life when the last few years had been so emotionally charged and explosive? It had started with the Easter Rising in 1916, when groups of Republicans seized control of buildings across the city, and Pádraig Pearse, one of the leaders, had read the proclamation of the Irish Republic on the steps of the General Post Office. The resultant military action by the British, who vastly outnumbered the volunteers and kept them under siege as they pounded them with artillery, did more than anything to turn the tide of public opinion against their rule. Until then, many families had been, if not supportive of the British presence, at least ambivalent about it, and a large number had regarded the Rising as unnecessarily provocative. But the high civilian casualties and the subsequent executions of the ringleaders by firing squad changed many minds and hearts. Winifred, who'd been 15 at the time and hadn't much cared who was running the country, had been shocked at the executions. But listening to her parents, she'd also thought that an armed uprising was a dangerous way to go about things. Her father, Thomas, insisted that there had to be a peaceful political solution, and would often bore Winifred and her sisters with his thoughts on what type of solution that could be. Not, he would admit, that the British seemed unduly interested in such a thing. In any event, the Rising had let the Republican genie out of the bottle. Almost 3 years later, a new provisional Irish government was formed at the Mansion House in Dublin, where a Declaration of Independence was read out and a new constitution established. And that had led to war. There were still people shouting and chanting outside the shop. Winifred realised she was holding her breath. "As though they could hear me breathe over their own yelling," she said to herself. "I should go outside and tell them to move on." But she stayed where she was. The War of Independence was a guerrilla war. And much as Winifred's views had evolved to agree with its ideals, she was tired of the escalating raids and reprisals. She was tired of never knowing what she might accidentally get caught up in. She was tired of the fighting on the streets, of the restrictions and the curfews, of the undercurrent of anxiety that was with her from the moment she woke up in the morning until she finally went to bed each night, relieved at surviving another day without a major incident. She desperately wanted the fighting to be over. But as she hugged her arms around her knees and continued to shelter beneath the counter, it seemed that peace was as far away as ever. The British had no intention of leaving, and as long as they were in the country, not a day would go by without trouble of some sort. It was a permanent feature of living in Dublin, no matter how hard she tried to avoid it. Not just of living in Dublin, of course, of living in Ireland. Of living. And it was exhausting. She recognised the names that were being chanted. They were all prisoners in Mountjoy jail who died on hunger strike earlier in the year. The hunger strikers were considered to be martyrs by most people, and even her father, who remained a pacifist despite, or maybe because of, what had happened to him in 1916, had read the reports of the death with fury at an administration that had allowed them to happen. Winifred couldn't imagine what it would be like to voluntarily stop eating. In the course of her 19 years, her family had gone through times of extreme hardship when her parents had struggled to put food on the table. And even though they were now, if not well off, certainly in less straitened circumstances, the idea of refusing food was almost impossible for her to imagine. Perhaps, she conceded as she pulled at a loose thread in her calico skirt, if it was for the sake of someone she loved, she'd consider not eating. And then she would have to chain herself to the gates of Dublin Castle like some of the more militant women had done to highlight the sacrifice she was making. Perhaps she'd even have her photograph on the cover of the nationalist newspaper, the Freeman's Journal. "Who am I kidding?" she asked herself as she banished the image from her mind. She was as much of a pacifist as her father. Her mother too. "Keep out of harm's way," Annie O'Leary would beg her every day. And every day Winifred promised she would. There'd been enough pain and suffering in their lives already. No sense in adding more. She took another deep breath and tried to control her racing heart. But it was hammering in her chest and pounding behind her eyes, making her dizzy. "Everything will be fine," she repeated over and over again. "Nobody will hurt you. Nothing will happen to you." But even when she realised she was right, and nothing would, because the shouts and the running footsteps had receded, she stayed where she was, unable to move. "Feckers," she thought, when she finally found the courage to lift her head and blink away the tears of relief that filled her wide brown eyes. "Scaring me like that." The bell over the shop rang as someone pushed it open. Winifred gasped and remained motionless, her arms hugging her knees, the metallic taste of fear in her mouth.
"Hello? Anyone here?"
It was a male voice, deep and rich, and the accent was a Dublin one. Winifred stayed where she was.
"Anyone? Are you all right?"
A pause before he continued.
"If you're unhurt, I leave. I'm not here for trouble."
Winifred emerged slowly from her hiding place. Splinters of glass fell from her dark hair and rattled onto the wooden floor. She shook out her skirt and more glass landed at her feet. Then she looked at the young man in front of her. In his 20s, she estimated. He was tall and thin, his arms and legs seeming too big for his body, his face gaunt yet composed. Black hair peeked out from beneath his flat cap, and he wore a green serge jacket over a faded shirt and matching trousers. The buttons on the jacket were brass, and she could see the harp etched on them. Relief that he seemed concerned rather than aggressive flooded through her, and she allowed herself to feel angry. She exhaled slowly and drew herself up to her full height. "And what's all this about?" She put her hands on her hips. "Do you think that throwing stones through the windows of decent working people is an acceptable thing to do, no matter what you're protesting about? Is this your idea of..."
"Stop!" He put up his hand. "The stone was a mistake. I'm here to tell you that. And to make sure you're not injured, although," he said with a note of concern, "you are. Your face."
"My face?" Winifred whirled round to look in the mirror behind her. She saw a thin line of blood from a cut just above her eyebrow tracing its way along her cheek. "Disfiguring us is the plan now, is it?" She turned around again. "When people aren't safe from their own kind in their place of work..."
"You think you were safe before?"
He raised an eyebrow. "The Brits never sent a rock through my window," retorted Winifred.
"I really do apologise, Miss... Mrs...
O'Leary," she said. "Winifred O'Leary."
"Are you the owner of this shop?"
He was unable to keep an element of surprise from his voice. Winifred knew that this was because she looked even younger than her age and certainly didn't have the presence of someone like Mrs. Kelly, even if she already knew enough to be a shop owner herself. She'd worked there ever since she'd turned 14, and there wasn't a question about fabrics she couldn't answer. She looked at the man again, struck by the fact that although his eyebrow had moved earlier, his eye hadn't. In fact, she realised, only one of his hazel eyes moved at all. The other remained staring at a fixed point behind her head. It was disconcerting. "I'm not the owner, but I am the person in charge," she replied. "And I can tell you now that someone is going to have to pay for the damage, and it's not going to be me."
"A minor inconvenience for Ireland's cause," he said.
"Oh, for the love of all that's holy," she glared at him. "A minor inconvenience. The window has to be replaced, the name repainted, the displays redone, the shop cleaned, and as for my fabric..." She gestured towards the blue silk that now lay flat and limp on the counter. "I have to get rid of this. Nobody wants a dress with glass fragments as decoration." He smiled. "And you can take that smirk off your face too," she added.
"It's not a smirk," he assured her. "I was just smiling because of course you're right. You shouldn't have to pay. Even if many people and businesses are willing to accept that these things happen in a time of war."
"Spare me," cried Winifred. "When Mrs. Kelly returns, she'll want her shop looking as perfect as it always does. And how am I supposed to do that with no money to pay for repairs?"
"If you're the person in charge, surely you can find some."
She gave him a withering look. "You think business is easy right now? More than a year into this damn war, and you imagine droves of women are rushing in here to buy nice fabric for clothes or for their homes, when they're afraid they could be pulled off the street at any time, or that their house could be raided. You men are all the same. It doesn't matter where you're from. Every single thing has to be resolved by fighting."
"Not our choice," he said. "And not only men either. There are plenty of women ready to fight for the cause."
"I'll give you that," she conceded, knowing that women's organisations like Cumann na mBan were active in the struggle and protested daily outside the prisons. "But it would be better to negotiate."
"They don't want to negotiate. When we win, and we will, you'll appreciate us. However," he added, glancing towards the blue silk again, "straightened times or not, you clearly have customers willing to spend a lot of money on fine cloth. Who would they be?"
"None of your business," she retorted.
Then her brow creased with worry. "It's an Irish woman," she said. "A good woman. Yes, she has some money, but the fabric is for dresses for her and her daughters, and I don't..."
"Forget it."
His tone was impatient. "I don't need the details of your customers. I don't care who's buying your silk." "I bet you do," she said in return. "But it really is nobody you need worry about. Nobody of interest to you."
"Nice material."
He rubbed it between his fingers, then murmured,
"Had I the heavens embroidered cloths."
"Poetry now, is it?" Winifred snorted. "The rest of us are having to put up with bullets in the streets and rocks through our windows. But Yeats can write poetry to a married woman and people think he's a genius."
"You're not an admirer, but you know his poetry."
"You sound surprised." She shook her head and more fragments of glass fell from her hair. "I'm an educated woman. My mother sent me to school. It means I can't be swayed by honeyed words, only by actions. And the action I'll be swayed by is if you fix the window of this shop." He lifted his eyebrow again. "What's bothering you now? My words or my demands?"
"Neither," he nodded. "You're right in every respect."
"So?" She glared at him. "Will you give me the money?"
"I'll do more than that," he said. "I'll arrange for the window to be replaced for you."
"You will you?" Her tone was sceptical.
"What time do you open in the morning?"
he asked. 9:30, she said. "Nobody buys fabric before 9:30.
"Someone will be here," he promised.
"And in the meantime..." She put her head to one side. "I'm missing a window. The shop isn't secure. You think I can go home and leave it open to any old bowsy who walks by so that he can help himself to bales of my fabric?"
"No," he said slowly.
"But I don't see how..." "That's the trouble with revolutionaries and rebels," she said. "You think of the moment and not the aftermath. Once you've got what you rebelled about, there's no plan."
"I assure you, Mrs. O'Leary, we always have a plan," he said.
"A plan to fix my window before the morning?"
"I can't fix the window until then, but I can secure the shop. Do you have wood or old crates? I can use them to board it up for you. But before that," he added, "you really should attend to your face."
"There are crates in the storeroom," said Winifred, opening the door that led to it. "And there are nails and a hammer too."
"I'll get on with it then, while you do something with that cut."
Winifred shrugged and turned away from him. She looked at her face in the mirror again. The gash above her eye had already begun to crust over, but she knew it should be disinfected. She followed the man to the storeroom, where she found the antiseptic lotion and cotton wool that Mrs. Kelly kept in a small tin box that had once contained OXO cubes. She dabbed her face, wincing at the sting of the antiseptic, and then fixed a small bandage over it. She wondered if she'd have a scar. Not that it mattered. A scar wouldn't mar her beauty, because Winifred wasn't beautiful. Even her own mother described her as plain, although Annie O'Leary would occasionally concede that she had nice eyes, which was true. Winifred's brown eyes added a spark of mischief in a face that might have lacked conventional beauty but was full of character. Those dark eyes narrowed as she watched the Republican bring slats of wood onto the shop floor and begin to survey the broken window. He was so sure of himself and his cause, so sure he was going the right way about it, and so insistent that he had a plan too. "Everyone has a plan," she thought, "until they run into the opposition's better one." He whistled as he hammered the wood into place. He was a quick, efficient worker, and it didn't take long until the gap was covered by the wooden slats. The interior of the shop was now dim, and she turned on the single electric light so that she could see to clean up.
"Do you have another brush?"
he asked when she began sweeping the glass. "In the storeroom," she said.
He fetched it and began sweeping too. They worked in silence until the counter and the floor were free of glass.
"Tomorrow," he said. 9:30.
"I'll say thank you when it's done," she told him.
"Of course.
But in the meantime, I'm obliged for you helping me tidy up."
"You're welcome, Mrs. O'Leary."
He tipped his cap to her, opened the door and left the shop. Winifred leaned against the countertop and released a breath she didn't even realise she'd been holding. She was trembling now from the shock of it all. The stone through the window had frightened her, but the shop door opening had terrified her. She hadn't known who might come in and what might happen to her as a result. She'd been lucky. She smoothed down her skirt again, then looked at the clock. There was still an hour to go before she was supposed to close the doors. But nobody was going to come into a shop with a boarded up window. And nobody was going to come in while there was still trouble in the streets. So she turned out the light, walked out of the door, and locked it carefully behind her. She turned onto an almost deserted Sackville Street and crossed the bridge, stepping carefully between the tram tracks before walking along the quays. The city was quiet. Whatever flashpoint had caused the riot was now over. The sun shone from a milky blue sky, and a light breeze carried the strong malty smell from the Guinness brewery further up the river, causing her to wrinkle her nose in disgust. The few people still around were walking with a sense of purpose, clearly eager to be somewhere else. Winifred walked with a sense of purpose too. It took her just 10 minutes to reach her family home in East Essex Street, two adjoining rooms in a tall building facing north towards the Liffey. It was a well-maintained property in a city that had many seriously overcrowded tenements, and the rooms were surprisingly spacious. Just 6 families lived in the building, and each tenant had an individual door. Years ago, 8 O'Learys had lived together, but now it was only Thomas, Annie and Winifred. Her older sister, Katie, was married and living in the country along with her younger brother, Tom, who Annie had sent to stay with her at the start of the war. She had hoped he would be safer there than in the city, but there were daily reports of fighting in the country too, and Winifred knew that her mother was torn between wanting her son near her and hoping that he really was better off with his older sister. Katie had only been to Dublin once since her marriage, and Winifred thought that living outside the city didn't really suit her, because although she was unquestionably the prettiest of all the O'Leary girls, with her long curly hair and soft creamy skin, she'd looked thin and worried when she'd visited. And it wasn't that anyone wouldn't be worried with the country in the state it was in, but Winifred couldn't help wondering if it was married life, living in the country, or the war that had put the frown lines on her sister's forehead and left dark circles under her eyes. But they hadn't had time to share confidences. Not that they ever had very much. Katie had always kept her own counsel. 2 other sisters, Mary Jane and Rosie, had moved to England shortly after the rising. Their reasons for leaving weren't political. The 2 girls had worked at the Jacob's Biscuit Factory on Bride Street, but had been fired for inappropriate behaviour and had struggled to find anything else. When their mother learned that their inappropriate behaviour had been laughing as they packed biscuits, she'd asked the Irish Women Workers Union to help. But after Rosie admitted that their laughter had been because their supervisor, Mr. Potts, wore his few strands of hair in a way that tried to hide the fact that he was almost completely bald, the union representative had suggested that protecting workers who laughed at the boss was hardly what it was set up for. She told Annie that their aim was to improve working conditions for women and girls, not intercede for those who'd mocked their employers. Annie had been furious, retorting that young girls were entitled to have a bit of fun at work.
"But not at the boss's expense, Mrs. O'Leary," the rather austere woman from the union had said. "Not for being disrespectful."
Annie hadn't wanted her girls to leave the country. But in the end, The move to England had been a good one for both of them, because they'd found well-paid jobs. At first, Annie had worried how two Irish girls would fare in London, especially given the attitude of the British press, which frequently portrayed the Irish as ungovernable, drunken louts. But after a year, Mary Jane had married an Englishman and was now settled in Kent, and Rosie, who was working in a London hospital, had recently written to say that she was seeing a young man herself. A pilot, she'd said, underlining the word four times. From Belgium, and very handsome. This last had been underlined four times too. In any event, as both Annie and Winifred sometimes said to each other, it was all very well fighting to get the British out of Ireland. But the girls were doing well in England, and it seemed churlish to shout slogans when they were benefiting from being there. As for Winifred's youngest sister, Marianne, she was no longer living at home either, being in service to a doctor's family in Pembroke Road. Annie hadn't particularly wanted Marianne to go into service, but the Desmonds were good employers, and Marianne talked about learning what she could from the doctor so that perhaps one day she could work for him rather than the household. As a secretary, she'd said, or an assistant. Annie had her doubts, particularly as Marianne's writing was poor and she'd been known to faint at the sight of blood, but she kept them to herself. Her daughter was happy, and that was the most important thing. It was, in fact, Mrs. Desmond who'd ordered the blue silk from Kelly's. Marianne was due to pick it up before the end of the week. "And now there's just me," thought Winifred, as she climbed the stairs and put her key in the lock. The last girl at home. She pushed the door open. Her mother, who was scrubbing the wooden table with carbolic soap, looked up at her in surprise.
"What are you doing here so early?"
she asked, a note of concern in her voice. And then, as she saw the bandage on her daughter's face,
"What happened?"
Winifred told her about the stone through the window and her encounter with the volunteer.
"Dear Mother of God,"
Annie shook her head,
"will it ever end? What was today about?" "I'm not really sure. They were shouting the names of the hunger strikers, but I don't know why. They were released weeks ago."
"Though more have been imprisoned since," remarked Annie.
Winifred nodded.
"Your woman was supposed to be giving a speech today,"
Annie recalled.
"The Countess."
"Markovitz."
Winifred looked surprised.
"I thought she was on the run."
"Still giving speeches."
Annie dropped her scrubbing brush into a metal pail and put it in the corner before drying her hands on a well-worn towel.
"She's brave," acknowledged Winifred. "Stupid, maybe, but brave."
"She has the luxury of being stupid," said Annie. "We don't."
Stupid wasn't really the right word for the woman who was a leading light in the Republican movement, Winifred mused, as she slipped off her shoes and rubbed her tired feet. Perhaps rash was a better description. Nevertheless, Winifred couldn't help admiring the fact that the Countess had the courage of her convictions. She very much doubted that if she herself had been born to an English baronet and brought up on the family's country estate in County Sligo, she'd have thrown her lot in with the Irish freedom fighters and taken up arms against the considerably better financed and organised British. Even more to admire was that the Countess had been appointed as Ireland's Minister for Labour. It was heartening, Winifred thought, to see women in positions of power. Not that the Countess could do much, given that at the time of her appointment she'd been imprisoned in Holloway, but Winifred liked her ideas. Now, despite her release, she was staying at safe houses, only emerging to make rousing speeches about women's rights and Irish freedom.
"Your head's in the clouds again,"
said Annie, as she reached past Winifred to get her coat, which was hanging from a peg on the door.
"Just thinking about the Countess," Winifred said. "She's amazing, really. She could be living in luxury, but she's true to her beliefs. You don't need that coat, Ma," she added. "It's a warm day."
"It won't be warm by the time I'm coming back," said her mother.
I suppose not.
There's coddle for your daddy's tea, added Annie. She nodded at the pot of potato and sausage stew suspended over a fire of barely glowing embers. Yours too, of course.
Thank you, said Winifred.
You're a good girl. Annie smiled at her and suddenly looked younger than her 48 years.
I hope that so-called freedom fighter does what he says.
If he knows what's good for him, he will. Winifred's voice was firm, but she smiled in return.
Would you mind lining the drawers in the dresser for me while I'm out? Asked Annie, indicating the old scratched kitchen dresser propped against the wall.
I left a newspaper for it.
Of course.
I know you.
You'll read it first.
Annie laughed as she opened the door.
That's all very well, but don't forget to do the drawers too.
When her mother was gone, Winifred walked into the other room and pulled back the heavy curtain, fabric supplied by Kelly's at a discounted rate, that separated her bed from that of her parents, then lay down. She'd once shared this bed with two of her sisters. Now it was hers alone. Lining the drawers could wait. It was nice to have time to herself. It was nice to have the bed to herself too. Winifred enjoyed solitude, and she was glad that she had a couple of hours alone while her mother cleaned the steps of the Empire Palace Theatre. Annie O'Leary was a strong woman, and she'd brought her daughters up to be strong too. But right now, with the cut above her eye throbbing and feeling suddenly overwhelmed by the events of earlier, Winifred didn't feel strong at all. She felt tired. But at least she could rest until her father came home looking for his tea. She surprised herself by falling asleep. In her dream, she was wearing a blue silk dress, hiding behind an upturned table beside the young rebel who'd come into the shop that day. He was telling her to take aim, and she shrieked in horror at realising she had a rifle in her hand. The shriek, whether aloud or merely in her dream, woke her, and she sat upright in the bed, her heart thumping in her chest once again.
I'm spending altogether too much time in a state of panic, she told herself as she swung her legs over the side of the bed and got up. Things aren't as bad as all that. It's just been a hard day.
She pushed the sash window open a little further, allowing the malt-scented air into the room. Then she took the neatly folded paper her mother had left on the shelf for her to line the drawers with. The newspaper was an old copy of the Freeman's Journal, and the lead story, coincidentally, was about the hunger strikers. Despite already knowing how things had turned out, there had been a general strike in support of the prisoners, who were looking for political status and better conditions, and as she said to Annie, they'd already been released. She still read it. The country had come to a standstill in the 2 days of the strike. Even Mrs. Kelly had decided it was better to close the shop than stay open. And the result had been worth it, although the British had in fact made a mistake and released all the Irish prisoners, even the non-political ones, much to the horror of the authorities and the amusement of the hunger strikers. As she read, Winifred wondered how it was that the British managed to control so much, given that they were forever making strategic errors. And she wondered too how the young volunteer she'd met earlier and his comrades could possibly prevail. Because the War of Independence was only one more step in the continued battle between the Irish and the British over the control of the island. From even before the beginning of the plantations, when English lords were given Irish lands, there had been nothing but rebellions, uprisings and battles. It was impossible to keep track of them all, but each one had left its scars and resentments. Winifred couldn't help wondering why the British thought it was worth it. Was it because they felt they'd lose face if they left? Or did they really believe they had a right to control a smaller country close by? She closed the paper with a sigh. One day, perhaps, people would look at the old newspapers and wonder about the events that had taken place years earlier. In the meantime, though, she'd do as her mother asked and use them to line the drawers of the kitchen dresser. Chapter 2. When Winifred arrived at the shop shortly after 9:15 the following morning, two men were leaning against the boarded-up window. One was tall and sinewy, the other shorter and squat, but both looked strong and capable, their rolled-up shirt sleeves emphasising the muscles in their arms. Beside them was a sheet of plain glass.
"We're here to do your window, missus," said the shorter of the two. "Porrig Shanahan and Anthony Walsh at your service."
"I'm glad you're punctual," said Winifred as she unlocked the door. "And I hope you're as good at replacing it as you are at breaking it."
"It wasn't us that broke it," said Porrig.
"But the lieutenant felt responsible."
"The lieutenant?"
"You met him yesterday."
This time it was Anthony who spoke.
"He's in our battalion."
"And what battalion is that?" she asked as she watched them take down the boards that the young lieutenant had so carefully nailed in place the previous day.
"The 3rd Battalion Dublin Brigade."
There was a note of pride in Porrig's voice.
"Well, you need to be more careful in future," she said. "It's one thing fighting the RIC. It's another destroying local businesses."
"It wasn't anyone from the battalion who broke your window," said Anthony. "There are always elements."
"I really don't care," said Winifred. "All I want is for it to be fixed."
She went into the storeroom and poured herself a glass of water. After a moment's hesitation, she poured two more glasses and handed them to Porrig and Anthony.
"Thanks, missus," said Porrig.
"Much obliged."
Anthony smiled at her.
He was the best looking of them all, she decided, with his taut frame, angular face and bright blue eyes. The image of yesterday's lieutenant and his fixed hazel eye came into her head. She suddenly realised that it was a glass eye, and that was why it hadn't moved. She supposed he'd lost his own in a guerrilla attack somewhere. She understood it, she admitted to herself as she cut away the blue silk that had been damaged in yesterday's incident. She understood what drove people to fight. But it was so relentless, and the victory so short-lived, that it was hard to know if it was worth it. Besides, she wasn't entirely sure she believed the speeches by people like Cathal Brua, the Minister for Defence, or even the Countess herself, insisting that having an Irish government would turn the country into a place where men and women were treated equally and poverty would be wiped out. From what Winifred could see, people changed the moment they got power. It was they and those around them that prospered. As for everyone else, they still had to get by as best they could. And Winifred reckoned that despite having a female Minister for Labour, it'd be a long time waiting before women were truly equal. How could they possibly be equal when men could vote at 21, whereas she had to wait until she was 30? 30! She wondered if that age had been decided because most women should be married by then and would vote how their husbands told them to. Not her, she thought. When she got the vote, she'd use it whatever way she wanted. All the same, she conceded, if you were going to mistrust powerful people, it would be better to mistrust your own and not those who took what was good from the land and left the rest. She wondered if the British believed everything they read in their newspapers about Ireland. And how many of them thought they had a right to run another country as they saw fit because they were told the people who lived there were somehow lesser than them? She couldn't believe the majority did. Rosie and Mary Jane's letters from London contained nothing but cheerful comments about the English and their love of order and tea and their royal family. Rosie occasionally mentioned that the Irish girls working with her at the big hospital in the city often did the jobs that the English girls didn't want to do, and that the English could be rude and dismissive towards them from time to time. But most were pleasant, and she didn't complain. She was happy. From their letters, it certainly seemed that London, in the wake of the war to end all wars, was a vibrant and glamorous place to be, and that the people were kind and generous. It was so hard to reconcile that with what was going on in Ireland. Dublin was probably as exciting as London right now, but it was the wrong sort of excitement. Tense was probably a better word to describe the atmosphere of the city. But how could you not be tense when the streets were full of policemen and soldiers and you could be stopped and arrested for nothing at all? And when the papers were full of war talk? Winifred wanted to read about people having fun, not battles. She wanted gossip. She wanted pictures of the latest fashions. She wanted excitement of her own. But she wouldn't go to England for it, even though she liked a nice cup of tea as much as the next person.
"There you are," said Anthony, bringing her out of her reverie. "One window, good as new."
"It'll be as good as new when you clean your grubby fingerprints off it," said Winifred. "And when you paint the name of the shop on the front, Kelly's Fine Fabrics, Prop Mrs. A. Kelly." Anthony looked startled.
"The lieutenant didn't say anything about painting names," he said. "We don't do painting."
"Neither do I," said Winifred.
"I'm sure you'll get someone, missus," said Porrig.
"It's Miss," snapped Winifred. "Miss Winifred O'Leary. Your lieutenant promised to put everything to rights, and it's not to rights until the name is painted on the window."
"He only asked us to replace it," said Anthony. "But I'll speak to him for you if it keeps you happy."
"You do that," said Winifred. "If I don't hear from him, I'll go looking for him, and he'll wish I hadn't." Anthony's mouth twitched.
"Don't you laugh at me either."
Winifred gave him a stern look.
"You'll find more sympathy from the Crown forces than me if you do."
It was later in the afternoon, and Winifred was folding yards of yellow chiffon for delivery to one of Mrs. Kelly's best customers when the brass bell jingled and the door opened. She looked up and saw the lieutenant, this time wearing a dark brown suit buttoned over a heavy cotton shirt.
"Miss O'Leary," he said, "I heard you weren't happy with the work."
"I'm perfectly happy with the work," replied Winifred, "but it's not finished. The name has to be painted."
"We never said anything about painting,"
the lieutenant echoed Anthony's words of earlier.
"Replacing the window without replacing the lettering isn't much good to me."
"I think I've been more than generous," he protested.
"Your band of merry warriors put a hole in my window, cut my face, ruined yards of my fabric, and caused me to have to close the shop early and lose sales," Winifred said. "So the least you can do is paint the name of the premises."
The lieutenant laughed. It was a surprisingly infectious laugh that completely changed his austere appearance and made him seem less autocratic and more approachable. Winifred felt a desire to laugh bubble up inside her too, but she clamped down on it firmly.
"You're the toughest negotiator I've ever had to deal with," he said as he composed himself. "We could do with you over in England talking to Lloyd George on our behalf. You'd reduce his government to agreement in no time."
"Possibly," agreed Winifred. "Most women have been negotiating forever. Negotiating good behaviour with our husbands and our children. Negotiating with our neighbours. Trying to fix the mess men have left behind even though they think they're in charge of us."
"Are you an activist?"
He looked at her with interest.
"You certainly seem to have a low enough opinion of men to be one."
"I don't have a low opinion of men. I just don't have the time to keep running after them to make sure they've done things properly. And I don't have time to be any sort of activist either," Winifred added. "Right now, I haven't time for anything other than my job and my family."
"But you don't actually have a family, do you?" he asked. "I called you Mrs. O'Leary yesterday and you didn't correct me."
"It's of little relevance to you whether I'm Miss or Mrs.," said Winifred. "Besides, I don't know your name at all."
"Joseph," he said. "Joseph Burke." "You get on well with me older sister," he added. "She's just as outspoken as you. She's in coming them on. I'm sure that's right up your street."
"Didn't I tell you I don't have time for protest groups?"
"They do a lot more than protest," Joseph said.
They were an integral part of the rising, which shows how equal we want women to be in the New Ireland. They also raise money for prisoners' families, and my main concern is going about my daily life without being shot at. She interrupted him. Do I think things could be better here? Yes. Do I think it will change? Not quickly enough. Do I think violence is the best way to do it? No. Can I change anything? Unlikely. Because you know what, Mr. Fancy Pants Lieutenant? All the people who are writing about change and talking about change and getting other people to put their lives on the line for change, no matter what happens, they'll be all right. Like your poet Yeats and his outrageous swooning over Maud Gone MacBride and her a married woman. And like the Countess too, no matter that I might agree with her. It's a game to them. Will their change really do anything for me or my mother or father? Or for you and your family? I sincerely doubt it. Because the people doing the real proper fighting instead of just talking about it are the working class and will always be the working class. And you can set up all the soup kitchens you like, but unless you change things for people who have to work for a living, then you're not really changing things at all. He stared at her, his natural eye as fixed as the other. The Countess has been in and out of prison for the past 5 years, he said. So she certainly made some personal sacrifices. You should definitely meet my sisters. A woman like you is wasted behind a counter. You should be out there encouraging people to fight for their rights. Winifred was conscious that this might be a dangerous conversation, and she usually steered away from dangerous conversations. Her whole upbringing had been about avoiding conflict. But there was something about Joseph Burke that made her want to keep talking, to argue her points with him. I think the Countess is a brave woman, but I don't think I'd actually have anything in common with your sisters, she said.
You absolutely would, insisted Joseph.
They want a better life for all of us.
Yes, there's protest. Yes, it can be difficult, but nothing happens without sacrifice. Don't you agree?
Of course I do, she said in a sudden rush. Of course I do, and of course I want Ireland to be a free country. But people are being killed every day, and that'll keep happening if we stay on this course. Each death is a tragedy for some family, and I read somewhere that more than 1,000 have been killed so far. I don't know if it's worth it.
You always have to pay the price for freedom, said Joseph, no matter how high.
It's easy for you to say, said Winifred, and then, remembering that he'd been injured in battle, felt herself flush slightly. I'm sorry. That makes it sound as though I don't think you put your money where your mouth is when clearly you already have.
I like being challenged, said Joseph. People don't challenge assumptions enough. We get ourselves stuck in our opinions and we all start to think the same way. Perhaps it's not always the right way.
Are you telling me I've steered you from the path of violence, Mr. Burke? She looked at him in sudden amusement. To one of peace and enlightenment?
Not quite yet, he smiled.
I should also have asked about your injury, Miss O'Leary. How is it today? I've had a lot worse, she said. And I feel as though I've done my bit for independence now that I'm scared for the cause. He laughed again. This time she did too. So, she said, when they were serious again. What about my window painting?
I'm very sorry, but I don't have anyone to do it, said Joseph.
I do know some arty people. I met them when I was in Frongoch. They did lots of brilliant drawings, but I don't think they'd be any good at painting shop windows. She nodded at his mention of the detention centre in Wales, where many men who'd participated in the rising, even peripherally, had been imprisoned. Were you there long?
6 months.
I'm sure that was difficult.
It was a mistake putting us all together so that we could plot and plan.
He laughed. To be honest, bad though the conditions were, the place was overrun by rats and I hate rats. It wasn't the worst experience of my life. I made some good friends. Decent men with shared ideals.
My father was shot in 1916, remarked Winifred.
He was a combatant.
Thomas's involvement was a story that was frequently recounted with amusement within the O'Leary family. But Winifred wasn't sure if she should share it with Joseph Burke.
It wasn't like that. She decided to tell him the truth. He was walking past Boland's mill during a lull in the fighting, and a stray bullet hit him in the leg. He's walked with a limp ever since.
I'm sorry, said Joseph.
Unless you were the shooter, it wasn't your fault. He was lucky. He lost his job at the docks, but knew someone who got him something at the custom house.
But that's the problem with violence, she added. It doesn't discriminate. You aim for the enemy. You can still hit a friend.
What do you want, Miss O'Leary? He asked.
Right now, all I want is that you get someone to paint my window.
I thought we agreed that it wasn't your window.
It's the window of the shop I work in. And I told you that Mrs. Kelly won't be happy if she comes back and finds things not as she left them. As it is, I'm having to get rid of the silk.
She gestured at the bundle of blue fabric behind her.
So that's another sacrifice. It's nothing but sacrifice from us.
He smiled, then put his hand in his pocket and took out some coins.
Will this cover you getting the job done?
He asked.
She looked at the money he placed in front of her.
It'll do, she said.
I hope so.
She picked up the coins and put them carefully in her purse.
I'll come back in a day or two, said Joseph, to check on the work.
You think I'll squander your money on feminine fripperies?
You might.
You don't know me.
No, said Joseph. You don't really know me either. Good day to you, Miss O'Leary.
Then he turned on his heel and walked out of the shop. Thomas O'Leary arrived home at 6 o'clock every evening. By then his wife had already left to clean the steps of the Empire Palace Theatre. But he knew Winifred would be waiting for him, ready to serve the dinner that Annie had left ready. He was lucky with his wife, he thought, and his daughter too. Annie was the love of his life, his soulmate. They were there for each other no matter what. And Winifred was a gem. You could always depend on her. She wasn't beautiful like Katie, or flighty like Rosie. Not cheery like Mary Jane or headstrong like Marianne. Winifred was the serious one who cared for others, who solved their problems, who put her family first. She was the one he leaned on. But when he opened the door and walked inside, the small wooden table in the corner of the room still hadn't been set with a knife, fork and enamel mug for his tea. He called out for her as he took off his boots. After nearly 30 years as a labourer at the docks, he was now a porter, and the work was less demanding on his footwear. The boots were serviceable enough for years to come, and there was no need to waste money on anything else. As he put them neatly beside the chair, he massaged the top of his leg where the bullet had entered 4 years earlier. The injury might have been deadly but for the doctor who'd been running towards him and had been beside him when he fell. It had all been so sudden. Thomas hadn't even realised what had happened, although, he often told himself afterwards, being shot was hardly unexpected given the number of casualties that had resulted from what had turned into a bloody battle. The doctor, William Desmond, had dragged him from the pavement to the shelter of the shrubbery near the canal. He'd staunched the bleeding and brought Thomas to the nearest hospital, where they'd removed the bullet and cleaned the wound. It was a twist of fate that Thomas's youngest daughter, Marianne, had recently found employment with Dr. Desmond. Thomas knew of Marianne's dreams to be more than just a housemaid. He had faith in them too, because even though she had a tendency to look before she leaped, Marianne had inherited her mother's iron will and strength of character. Every one of his daughters had. Nobody ever stood in the way of his girls.
I'm surrounded by women, he thought,
as he stretched his leg out in front of him.
Well, my only living son is on a farm in County Meath.
Hopefully Katie and her husband can keep him out of trouble there.
Boys got caught up in battles and this damn war could go on for years yet. The world would be better off run by women. He laughed at himself. Men would never take orders from women, no matter how intelligent they were. Men always wanted to be the ones in charge. He took out his watch and frowned. Winifred was now very late and he worried that something had happened to her. He'd been shocked to learn about the stone coming through the window of the shop the previous day and relieved it hadn't been anything worse. Alice Kelly had been married to an Englishman and the volunteers, the rebels, the Republicans, he was never sure what he wanted to call them, knew things like that. So they could easily decide to sack Kelly's fine fabrics and make an example of a young girl working there if they chose. His stomach tensed at the thought of what they could do to Winifred. At what he knew had been done to other women, especially if it had been decided that they were in some way collaborators or spies. Rape. And he shuddered to think of it. Murder too. Even though they called it execution and often left the bodies to be found by relatives. He got up and walked to the window, his big toes poking out of his socks. There were plenty of people in the cobbled street below, but he didn't see his daughter. And then, just as the knot of worry was working its way into something bigger, he heard the door open and she walked into the room. Winifred wasn't his favourite. That honour had been reserved for Mary Jane, who, Thomas thought, was the sunniest of them all. But Winifred was clever and independent, which was probably why she was leaving it a bit late to find a husband for herself. Not that she needed to rush into marrying anyone. Annie had preached that to the girls often enough. But Winifred didn't seem to care about men or marriage, even though at 19 she should surely be looking for someone. Although as he remembered again the things men did, he couldn't entirely blame her. "You're home," she said to him as she closed the door behind her.
"Where were you?"
he asked.
"Working."
"Until now?"
He frowned. She reminded him about the window in the shop and told him of her discussion with the young lieutenant about painting the name on it.
"And so," she said as she counted out coins onto the table in front of him. "I thought you could get your paint and your brush and do the job tomorrow, as it's Saturday."
He looked up at her and smiled.
"Not the prettiest daughter. Not the sunniest, but definitely the smartest."
"I didn't tell Mr. Burke that you'd once done a bit of painting at the docks," she added. "It wasn't something he needed to know."
"You're a good girl, Winnie."
He scooped the coins into his pocket.
"Thanks for thinking of your old da."
As he took his seat at the table and she ladled the tripe and onions that had been simmering in the pot onto his plate, Winifred was glad that although there were many men in Thomas's position who'd spend any spared money on drink, her father wasn't one of them. He rarely touched alcohol, and for that she was grateful. She'd seen how some men became after it, their inhibitions loosened, the baser parts of themselves released. Like Katie's husband. Winifred wondered with a sense of shock why she'd never thought of it before. Reed was a drinker, and his words turned coarse when he'd had a few pints. Perhaps that was why her sister now wore a permanently worried expression and had dark circles under her eyes. And maybe that was why Winifred herself had never liked her brother-in-law. She would write to Katie, she thought. Suggest she pay her a visit. Just to check things out for herself. See if she wasn't putting two and two together and getting five.
"Have you forgotten about the bread, Winnie?"
asked her father, his words bringing her back to what she was doing. "Sorry." She cut a slice from the loaf. "Will you paint the window tomorrow?"
"First thing," said Thomas. "Don't you worry, Winnie, my girl. It'll be as good as new when Mrs. Kelly comes back."
"I know it will." She kissed him on the head.
"And now, if I'm going to be doing all that extra work, how about a second slice of bread?"
"Coming up," said Winifred. "And after that, I'll darn your socks for you. I can't have my father walking around like Bigfoot."
"You're a wonder," said Thomas.
"I know," she told him, and handed him his extra bread to go with the tripe.
Chapter 3. The moment she arrived at her drapery shop on Monday morning, following her annual visit to her in-laws, Alice Kelly knew something was different. It took her a minute to see that the window was exceptionally clean. Despite her best efforts, the dust of the city meant it was usually grimier than she'd like. But more than clean, she thought as she went inside. It was positively sparkling. And the interior of the shop was positively sparkling too. The floor was swept and the wooden counter polished. The bales of fabrics, linens, cottons, velvets and silks, were neatly stacked on the shelves, and the boxes of sewing patterns and trays of buttons had been tidied. Winifred had been busy. Although, Alice said to herself as she took out the ledger, if Winifred had had time to clean and tidy so well, she couldn't have been selling much fabric. And indeed, she saw as she traced her finger along the assistant's neat looped handwriting, after a busy start to the week, things had tapered off towards the end. She sighed. The shop was profitable, but only if their sales stayed above a certain level. And thanks to that fall-off, Winifred's first, and probably only, week in charge had barely kept it on the right side of the red line. Alice looked up as the bell rang and Winifred herself stepped inside. "What on earth happened to your face?" she asked after they'd exchanged greetings. Her eyes opened wider and wider as Winifred told her of the riot outside, the stone coming through the window and her efforts to have it replaced. "That's dreadful," she said. "You poor girl. You must have been terrified." Winifred admitted that she had been. And there was no talk of, well, me, as proprietor of the shop. No, Winifred shook her head. It seems it was a protest that started somewhere else, and when they tried to break it up, people ran in all directions before regrouping. But they weren't trying to intimidate business people or anything like that. Alice looked relieved. "And all's well that ends well," said Winifred. "Because we have a new window and the old one already had a crack in it." "You've done very well," Alice smiled. "Very well indeed." "We lost sales, of course." Winifred knew exactly what was most important to her boss. "Yes, but at least I didn't lose you. I really don't know why there has to be all this violence."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.